long ago it must be. I have a photograph, preserve your memories, they're all that's left you.
There's a specific kind of nostalgia that people have when talking about Planescape Torment that reminds me a lot of when I first became aware of people talking about movies critically as more than just stuff you rented and watched and then rewound. My dad would say to me, "You know, Citizen Kane is the best movie of all time, according to almost everyone," and I knew that he was completely full of shit because that movie was Aliens and there was nothing that he could do about it. I never watched Citizen Kane when I was younger. I pretty much refused to. It was ancient, it looked boring, it was some kind of biopic. I couldn't muster up a drop of enthusiasm for it. But time passed, and at some point I got over myself enough to give it a try. Citizen Kane is, genuinely, a remarkable movie with a hell of a lot of complex elements to it. But I had to want to get it before I got it. Some larger part of the conversation about what good movies or bad movies even are had to click for me before I was able to approach the thing on its own terms and see why so many other people put this page-worn old classic in the number one spot so many years in a row. When I played Planescape Torment for the first time, it blew my teenage mind right open to what a dialogue-driven game could really be, even after having played Fallout for my first role-playing game. It flew up to my best-written game of all time spot and never really left. It's conventional wisdom among game critics that this is true, to the point that I find it kind of obnoxious to praise Planescape Torment this much as I agree with doing so. Look at the surface. This is a bizarre, one-off game from the makers of Baldur's Gate that ignores most things that make Baldur's Gate such a faithful Dungeons & Dragons adaptation in favor of a novelistic structure that ends up playing like a kind of surrealist mystery set in the worlds behind the worlds of the Planescape D&D setting. It uses 2nd edition AD&D rules, the most frustrating of popular and common tabletop rule sets, and before last year's enhanced edition of Planescape, it was still software that you had to tweak in order to get it to run on widescreen monitors. It was old. Real old, and odd, real odd, and yet any time someone makes a list of best role-playing games, there it sits at either number one or adjacent. It's one of those games whose evangelists seem split between old fans who hadn't gotten the game out of their head in the 2 decades since it came out, and critics who never found anything that scratched their narrative itch quite the same way again. Yet, Torment was back in the middle of the broader gaming conversation again in 2017, for a brief moment anyway. Not only was a modern edition of Planescape Torment released by Infinity Engine rehabber's Beamdog, but it also saw a spiritual successor in the form of a brand new isometric RPG called Torment Tides of Numenera. This new game is a kind of reprise of the thematic intent of the original, with a new campaign setting and a new rule set. In keeping with Planescape's rule of three, a third kind of Torment fan emerges, the kind who are seeing it for the first time and making fresh judgments. I never ended up agreeing that Citizen Kane was the best movie ever made. I think I still preferred Aliens in a lot of respects, but I could see why people have spent over 70 years talking about it. It's dense. It's meaningful. When it comes to Planescape Torment, I certainly don't expect newcomers to the game to put it in the same number one spot as I have, and so many others have, but I do expect they'll find that the reason people have been talking about this game for 20 years is that there is 20 years worth of things to talk about going on inside of it. So, at the center of the great wheel that makes up the heavens and the hells is a stone spire. It's said to be infinite, unscalable, but perched atop it is an eternal city, a loop of homes and businesses and secrets, rotating at the very heart of the cosmos. This is Sigil, the City of Doors. It is the gateway to everything. Every imaginable sensation, the most impossible living, the most excruciating deaths, the extremes and the moderates of all worlds, all possibilities, all things, in one looping sprawl of urban chaos. Sigil is part of a larger campaign setting known as the Planescape constellation of adventures, modules, and guidebooks, originally released for 2nd edition Dungeons & Dragons. Planescape took a bedrock mechanic of D&D and made it into something much more complex, something deeper in creative possibility. Dungeons & Dragons has always had a system of moral alignment, an 8-point compass with options for good or evil, law or chaos, and neutral in-between shades, including the dead center 9th option of true neutral. Planescape takes that compass and uses it to draw the whole map. 3 heavens for lawful good, neutral good, chaotic good, 3 hells, neutral planes with moral aspects of its transition zones ballooned into disturbing characteristics, and then the outlands at the center, the true neutral plane that keeps the different realms connected, but sovereign from each other. And at the center of that, a spire, a city. These are the worlds where souls go after they die on the material plane, in the regular world. These are the places where every evil wizard and valiant hero go to find their rewards at the end of their brief but adventuresome lives. This is the other side of the portal that sorcerers of more conventional fantasy campaigns summon their demons from. Nothing conceivable is off-limits, because most of what's conceivable has already been categorized into locations and factions representing, physically, a wide array of doctrines and abstract philosophies. These are worlds built on principles of belief, of ideas, of intentions. Let's take the lawful side of the compass, for example. The lawful good gods of Mount Celestia live in order and peace, benevolent action and benevolent policy dictating their future into eternity. But move 90 degrees around the great wheel of the inner planes and you'll hit Mechanus, a lawful neutral plane. Here, order is all that matters, and the entire plane is a series of interlocking gears, hundreds if not thousands of miles in diameter, operating in perfect synchronicity. Harmony and law, in the balance of organized empirical truth. Another 90 degrees on the wheel and you'll have gone from a heaven to a hell, the nine hells of Bator. Each hell of Bator is unique and infinite, but collectively they're home to demons who use organization, bureaucracy, and the cruelty of an unfair bargain to damn and torment the many universes of the material plane. From Dr. Faustus to Faerun, if humans have ever sold a soul to a demon, that transaction was logged here, in Bator. For contrast, just 45 degrees further along the wheel is the Abyss, chaotic evil, demons of hunger and pain, animalistic, howling, nonsensical, a place of true, deep monstrousness. This is all very surface level. There are pages and pages and more pages of world building in the Planescape setting for each of the nine hells of Bator, each of the seven heavens of Mount Celestia, reams of wildly creative material dedicated to, essentially, mapping a cosmology of myth and legend that's tailored with incredible specificity to the challenges and choices that face Dungeons & Dragons player characters. There are worlds behind the worlds, and they are weirder and wilder and more wonderful than the mortal realms which refer back to them. This is Planescape. Planescape Torment is a game where you can have a minutes-long conversation with a character who gives no quest and serves no purpose other than to add flavor and texture to a scene and a place, and then walk away feeling like you learned something important and new anyway. It is, first and foremost, a deliberate and focused narrative story. It's a Dungeons & Dragons campaign second. You do not play a many-faced savior of the kingdom. Instead, you're a stranger to yourself. You're an immortal amnesiac. The game begins with you waking up on a mortuary slab with no memory of yourself, covered in a spiderweb of intricate tattoos that give cryptic advice on what to do next. If you die mechanically during the course of the game, you just wake up again sometime later back at the mortuary, or in some other pile of bodies or trash. In past incarnations, you have been cruel and kind in alternating lifetimes, sometimes crazy, sometimes calculating. Whatever you choose this time around will have some resonance with a past self. It isn't truly determining a binary good or evil destiny, as is so often the case with these games, some kind of red or blue ending. Your character has already been both good and evil in many ways and many places. It's about the player coming to terms with the character that they're inhabiting, finding sympathy, finding connection. You are not the Nameless One. That character is a wholly independent thing from the player, unlike the extensive character creation processes of other games where the PC is a direct representation of the whims and motivations of the player themselves. Torment is notable, actually, for having fewer mechanical resolutions to quests than you'd generally see in Baldur's Gate or similar, but having many, many more ways to subjectively respond to those things in dialogue. There's not always a good path and then a separate evil path, just a single choice of to walk the path or not, and then anywhere from 4 to 8 possible answers for why you choose to walk the path to begin with. Let's look at this late-game example that's become kind of classic in terms of showing how unusual the game is and its dialogue trees. You're in conversation with the Night Hag Ravel, an ancient and powerful witch creature, who is the one, long ago, that split the Nameless One from his mortality and set him on the path of cyclical forgetting. She asks the game's signature question, what can change the nature of a man? You get 15 truths and a lie to answer with, and mechanically speaking, any of these are fine choices. None generate a game over screen, or give you an item, or a bonus, or a penalty. It's asking you to answer, because the answer itself matters. You can answer truthfully as the player, or as the player character, either is okay. The important thing is that you are made aware of the narrative importance of the question, and the narrative weight of the response. And there is a good reason for this answer to be so open-ended. It's not the first time that Ravel's asked the Nameless One. The answer isn't permanent. You have answered differently in the past. If you forget yourself again, then you may have to answer differently again in the future. Ravel only cares about your truth this time. The second of the major governing principles of the Planescape setting is called the Center of All principle. It says that, in a great wheel that contains multiple warring infinities and realms even farther beyond, the only center of the universe that matters is what you see in front of you at a given time. Your subjective truth, your personal reality, is the only thing that you can act on. That subjectivity can have power, real power, the power to reshape worlds, the power to change the nature of a man. This isn't a story about saving the world. It's a story about saving the self, or trying to, at least. The Center of All principles suggests that the stakes are equally high for either endeavor. The most visible difference between Planescape and other early BioWare titles, besides the obvious shift in setting and art style, is the approach to companion characters. Baldur's Gate had a wide variety of NPCs who you came to know, outside of a couple plot-important exceptions, in a kind of superficial, adventuring acquaintance kind of way. Baldur's Gate 2 featured more complex interactions, but in Baldur's Gate 1, the purpose of an individual party member comes down to their class, their build, and how you want to configure your six-member party for the many hours of rules-heavy combat to come. Planescape Torment has you going huge stretches without any combat at all, and when combat happens, it's often insular and brief. The mechanical purpose of the party member becomes secondary to their narrative purpose. It's not that they didn't consider the mechanical purposes. The order that you meet your companions in corresponds to the rising slope of character level and combat difficulty, so you get a priest by the time you need one, for example, if you've got your eyes and ears open anyway. Planescape Torment almost completely rejected the idea of recreating a live tabletop-style adventuring party, even a planar-flavored one, which is significant considering how much of Baldur's Gate is directly related to that translation effort. There are only 7 possible companions in the game, and you can only travel with 5 at a time. One of those extra 2 doesn't show up until the last few hours of the game, and another is hidden in a puzzle box optional dungeon. You won't even find a 4th party member until 6 or a dozen hours into the game, depending on your vulnerability to distraction. The more novelistic structure of the game means that each character has history and context that needs to be dramatically introduced, and that takes something a little more deliberate and predetermined than a "What ho, traveler!" shouted across a crowded tavern. It also leads to deeper, more vivid characterizations in the game's script. Baldur's Gate's tabletop approach lent itself to characters that felt like certain archetypes and quirks that a live player might come up with themselves, like the strong and noble ranger who's not all there in the head, or the aloof, confident druid, or the condescendingly sultry drow priestess. A pen and paper player's character sheet has a couple paragraphs worth of space for a good backstory on it, and so those NPCs were given an equivalent couple paragraphs worth of attention. Here, the Nameless One is an eternal, undying blight on the Great Wheel. He outlasts any who travel with him. He brings suffering to those who care for him. He brings torment, which is why the companions seek him out in the first place. Each character has some essential, unresolved duality at the center of their being that causes them great pain. They are, as an explicit plot point, conflicted beings who see in the Nameless One some sort of reflection of their own pains, and maybe some hope of resolving their inner turmoil. No one would volunteer at a tabletop setting to play these characters. Their concerns are secondary to the larger plot, although thematically they do prop up a lot of it. They are, pretty universally, sad and broken in some fundamental way. And they all know they'll probably end up dead helping the Nameless One track down his long-lost mortality. They are too much their own people to accommodate player motivations like ego-driven heroism, raw profit, and the kind of touristy sense of adventure that leads to 6 people wandering the countryside asking folks if they have goblins that needed to be slain. All their lives were more robust and complicated than that before the Nameless One even came along. The most miserable and complicated among them is Dakon, a githzerai from the chaotic neutral plane of Limbo. Thoughts shape reality in Limbo. Dakon was once an important and respected warrior among his people, but strength is only as good as focus in that plane. If you believe the walls are strong, the walls will be strong. If you become unsure, the walls will lose their surety as well. To lose faith, to question, can be a deadly thing in Limbo. And so Dakon's life among his people ended the moment he looked out on the ever-shifting chaos of Limbo and found more reflection of himself there than in the disciplined ideal the Gith try to adhere to. He was ready to die an outcast, floating in the mutating nothingness, when a stranger came to him. The stranger asked Dakon to pledge his service to him, a solemn and unbreakable thing, for as long as that man lived. In return, he would give Dakon back his faith. It did not occur to Dakon that the stranger might not be able to ever die, that the offer was not a contract, that it was slavery disguised with words he wanted to hear. That was long before the game opens. You, the player, meet Dacon, funnily enough, in a tavern. The smoldering corpse bar, featuring the unbeatable centerpiece of a man permanently, endlessly being ravaged by flames. Dacon says you're a stranger to him this time, too, and he's right in a way. There is no telling who the Nameless One will be this time. But Dacon will travel with you again, and only reluctantly and slowly will he concede that it is not the first time. The thing about Dacon that's so remarkable is the weight of his regret and his exhaustion. He's very, very old by the time you see him. He has tethered his life to one who forgets the debt he has irrevocably sworn to repay. Underneath the dust and misery, there's brilliance, skill, courage, but it's all corroded and rusted over, muddied, worn down by the many decades of near-constant disappointments and betrayals. The incarnation that came to Dacon in Limbo is one of three major incarnations you come across evidence of. This is called the Practical One. That sounds complimentary, but it's an extreme practicality. That incarnation was manipulative and goal-oriented in a way that only an immortal could ever be. Other lives were nothing to him. But Dacon was more than a life. He was a weapon. He wields a thing called the Karak Blade, fashioned from the chaotic material that makes up the plane of Limbo. It's shaped by his mind. In conversation, the blade will ripple with anger, turn black with sorrow, sharpen into a jagged edge with hate, smooth over with calm. The Nameless One, before the player knew him, only wanted the blade. But the blade is useless without the mind wielding it. Faith shapes it. Belief sharpens it. Dacon's crisis of faith would have to be resolved for him to be useful to the Nameless One. And so the game's most spectacular betrayal was conceived. You can go through the game as either a fighter, a thief, or a mage, but the game is actually narratively hinged on choosing the mage in a number of places in a way that it isn't for the other classes. The Nameless One's very first incarnation was a mage also, and he's been one many times again since then. If you've taken this path, and only if you've taken this path, Dacon will introduce you to his most sacred religious object, the Unbroken Circle of Xerthamon. It's a scripture in a puzzle box in one, a thing that unfolds its lessons one at a time and yields magic for you to copy into your spellbook if you learn the lesson well. The Nameless One, your Nameless One, discusses each lesson as he learns it with Dacon. The first circle, the first lesson, is interpreted by the Nameless One to mean, strength lies in knowing oneself. I learned that if someone does not know themselves, they are lost. They become a tool for others. This is an intense, secret cruelty in saying these words to this creature at the beginning of this lesson. Xerthamon is the long-gone Gith revolutionary who did, in D&D's own dense mythology, free the Gith from slavery and precipitate the civil war between the Githzerai, of whom Dacon is one, and the Githyanki, who appear in Baldur's Gate 2 and Neverwinter Nights 2 as a monstrous race. Xerthamon didn't write any of this. The Nameless One did. The whole thing is something the practical incarnation made himself as an artificiality in a few days when pondering how best to sharpen Dacon's mind, and in doing so, sharpen his blade. Dacon lost the knowing of himself. He was ready to die. And in not knowing himself, he was made a tool for others. The lessons he learns are ones that the Nameless One wanted him to learn, and by following the path of study yourself, you are being instructed and manipulated by your own past self as well. There are philosophical maxims that come to define Dacon's outlook, like endure, and in enduring grow strong, that end up feeling familiar. Words that feel more comfortable in the Nameless One's mouth than any other. You begin to realize this as you get deeper into the circle and discover that there are parts of the circle that Dacon himself has not been able to unlock yet. As you go on ahead of him into the learning, you teach him what you've learned. You are each disciples now to a past incarnation. But you see the craft of it. There are passages that seem deliberately included for no other purpose than to lead Dacon to an acceptance of Xerthamon's betrayal, the proclamation of two skies that turned the Gith from one race into two. Dacon said that this is where his faith was lost, where he lost himself, in doubting Xerthamon's words and actions in this moment. The circle leads him to a conclusion that he doesn't want to accept, an answer that isn't, as he put it, a true knowing of the lesson. It is because of the circle that Dacon is broken still. The essential conflict, the deep-rooted torment of his life, has taken cancerous root because of your long-ago manipulations. The Githzerai value freedom above all. But the scripture was meant to keep Dacon a slave. Yet there are lessons there which have real value to the Nameless One on his journey. The circle, as traveled by the new incarnation, has new weight, In learning it together with Dacon, in questioning it together, the Nameless One can encourage him to find new meaning in old words. You can heal this wound and break these chains by encouraging Dacon to see his beliefs in a new way, a way that gives him actual peace. Belief can change the nature of a conversation. A conversation can change how you know yourself. That's the thing about the villainy of the older incarnations of the Nameless One. He wasn't a great king, or a demigod, or anything so flashily important. Instead, he was the wrong person at the wrong time in both political and personal moments over and over again across truly inhuman amounts of time, and in doing so was the catalyst to some profound evil. For example, the smoldering corpse in the middle of that bar is your doing as well. And again, you won't find out if you don't bother to become a mage. The player learns magic from an old woman named Mebeth, a little gray-haired crone with a hut in Ragpicker's Square. She sends you on a multi-stage fetch quest designed to test your patience, sending you out one at a time for ink, rags, and eventually a barbed frame, which she assembles into a spellbook for you if you put up with her teasing inconveniences. Mebeth is, for all her testing to see if you actually care about learning magic, kind. She wants you to learn. She delights in your mastery. Careless magic can burn the world down, as a mage named Ignis tried to do many years ago. He went mad and burned down half the slums, and so was trapped by other wizards in an endless stream of flames, consuming him forevermore, a punishment that seemed to be pretty welcome by Ignis. Ever since, he's been providing heat, light, and a few coppers worth of curiosity at the smoldering corpse bar, becoming less and less frightening as the community he tried to murder reduces him to decor, and the searing heat of his anger fades from memory. In the game, you find a decanter of endless water, and if you seek out the one who knows its magical command word, you can return much later in the game to the smoldering corpse bar and free Ignis. The water and the flames cancel each other out. Ignis will always smolder, but he is no longer trapped. The first thing he sees is you, and the first thing he feels is hate. You can ask Ignis to teach you his mastery of the flames, and Ignis will laugh. Why? It was you who taught him. You took him in as an apprentice. He always had a fascination with fire, but you taught him more than magic. You taught him resentment. Knowledge is pain, you said to him once, and then you hurt him, and then you hurt him again, over and over, delighting in the cruelty. Each of the four spells you learn from Ignis has a cost, a real mechanical cost, reducing your hit points permanently as the wounds weaken you. Ignis will melt the flesh from your hands, pluck the eyeball out of your head. He will hurt you and do it gleefully. But you will learn the lessons well. The power he has to teach is real. Ignis is the villain here. He's the one who burned the slums down, the one who people still blame. But you're the one who gave him his resentment, who fostered his wrath, who knocked flint and steel together over the loose papers and dry grass of a young man's nature, and actually set it to burning. You are not the villain, but you share the blame. Ignis is too far gone to ever recover. If you play a good or neutral character, you'll have to kill him in the end. When Ignis teaches you magic, his absolute loathing for you is thick and heavy. His joy in making you feel pain, in making you ask to be hurt by him, is both disturbing and very human. Ignis is an insane murderer, power mad and destruction hungry. But he didn't start out that way. He learned it from you. Not every change you inspire is negative, though, like with your very first companion, the floating talking skull. Mort is, at first glance, a gag character. He's a jokester in personality and a bit of a joke visually and mechanically as well. Like, he can't use weapons or armor or really any inventory item, but throughout the game you find new teeth that you can give him to upgrade his damage. You can find new curses and taunts for him to learn, which he can use to piss off spellcasters and goad them into attacking him in melee combat. It's a great mental image. The powerful mage, energies swirling around him, preparing to unleash arcane destruction, and then this floating skull with a vaguely New Yorkish accent calls him a name so insulting, so absolutely infuriating, that he stops channeling the complex energies of the multiverse to immediately go over and punch that stupid skull right in its stupid face. There's a museum and gallery in the later game that features a statue of a great wizard from ancient times, turned to stone moments before he unleashed a curse so powerful it could strike anything dead. You can find a balm to unpetrify him. If you do so, he finishes his curse, looking the Nameless One dead in the eyes, confused about where he is, but determined to finish his curse. The curse boils the brain inside of your skull. You die, for a little while anyway, until you wake up again on the museum floor. Mort is a little sorry for your trouble, but mostly he's just beside himself with giddiness to have heard something so arcanely insulting it has the power to kill. The effectiveness of his taunts will be increased for the rest of the game. If you stay on the surface level, Mort is exactly like this, a joke character. a gimmick, although a good and memorable one. Later on in the game, you discover that among the instructional tattoos on your back that more help you read the very beginning to get your bearings, there was an additional line of script that says, "Don't trust the skull." The second layer to the character is that Mort is, as part of his essential nature, a compulsive liar. He exaggerates, distorts, leaves things out. Once in the distant past, his lies got the Nameless One killed. People and creatures whose lies are lethal go to a particular place in Beitor, a pillar of skulls reaching into the sky, wailing in misery. The Nameless One, seeking answers about where to find his lost mortality, went there once. Mort recognized him, a skull in the pillar. Told him there were many answers if he'd just take Mort away out from the pillar with him. And this was partly true. Mort may have, you know, suggested that he knew more than he did, but he did get to escape Beitor. When you wake up at the beginning of the game, though, Mort is there, waiting patiently. Now, he could have just left. It's not like you'd recognize him. So why, if he betrayed you once, if his he was so disliked by you in the past that you tattooed on your body not to trust the guy, why does he stay? That's the third layer, the layer of Mort's own torment. He's been a liar, that's true. Mort could have told you everything from the very beginning, the whole story, but he doesn't, because he feels like this time, maybe you'll actually like him. Maybe you'll actually forgive him. Maybe you'll be his friend. But that this would be impossible if you knew the whole truth. When you find out that he was holding back on you, you have every right to be very angry. You can even put him back in the Pillar of Skulls when the loop of your journey eventually takes you there as the player. But he wasn't lying when he said that he was your friend. He regrets what's happened to you. Mort's always been a liar, and that's what he knows to do. But he wants to be more than that. He wants to be better. To have that happen, he needs to tell the truth and be forgiven, or else he'll just keep lying to minimize his exposure to the consequences of the past. The tattoo says, "Don't trust the skull." But why should you trust the tattoos of a past self you know to be entirely unreliable, possibly evil? Will you see Mort as you always have, or could both of you be someone new this time around? Simply believing in someone can have transformative effects in this game, mechanically so with a hidden companion, Nordum. In a curiosity shop in one of Sigil's richer wards, you can buy a strange little figurine. It's a model of a Modron, a kind of hybrid of a crab and a television and TV's Gumby. They come from the plane of Mechanus, and they're beings of pure law, pure reason. And this business of adventuring that's so popular on the Prime Material plane, well, that is not a reasonable thing at all. So why do it? This is how the Modrons, servants of the ever-turning gears of Mechanus, went to the chaotic plane of Limbo and built a dungeon-generating machine. This figurine, if you twirl his little arms and legs in just the right order, opens a portal to that machine. The game itself is programmed to generate new dungeons on demand, a sequence of several dozen rooms on three different difficulty levels. You're the first actual adventurers to ever see it. It has helpful items, like a piece of paper with the words, "A clue," written on it, which goes on to further say, if you flip it over, "You understand what's going on better now." Thank you, Modron Note. Most helpful. The whole thing is a pretty funny critique of the dungeon crawl experience, something that Planescape Torment itself took extreme pains to avoid being. Except here. If you want a dungeon crawl, buddy, you've got it, endless and devoid of meaning or purpose. But if you crank the difficulty up to hard, two unusual rooms will be introduced to the labyrinth. One is the lair of the villain Modron, and the other is a room that's decayed and leaked into the chaos of Limbo beyond. A Modron, sent to investigate, is standing there, mesmerized by it. Modrons, in addition to being lawful and mechanical, have a kind of collective essence. One is as good as another, and they want the same things. But this Modron's connection to the whole has atrophied in the face of raw chaos. He is an individual. A backwards Modron. Nordum. His essential conflict is clear and, unfortunately, irresolvable. He is one of a thing that, by definition, must be many. He will never be a Modron again. In operating the Modron maze, the Nameless One assumes the title of creative director of it. He is, in effect, Nordrum's boss. So Nordrum will come to you and attempt to adventure with you. Nordrum feels confused and lost and purposeless. He's an aberration, a fluke, but he's still a being of logic and routine. If you're the creative director, then your opinion is trustworthy. If you tell him to be stronger, faster, more himself, he'll listen to you. Nordum isn't just a name, it's a role. It's something that he can be, that he can define for himself and pour meaning into. There is no such thing as a lone Modron. Nordum is something new, something different. If he believes in himself, he can become more of himself. He can find resolution and satisfaction and strength in the understanding of his own name and his own self-perception. Nordum struggling to define himself, having lost his chance to participate in the preordained destiny of his people. But suppose you rejected that destiny outright, tell the multiverse to take this job and shove it. Hardly anything on the planes are more set in their ways and predictable than the lawful evil devils of the Betizu and the chaotic evil demons of the Tanari. It's part of the cosmic balancing act of the multiverse. They hate each other so much that the struggle between the two opposite expressions of supernatural evil hobbles their ability to overwhelm the prime material planes or the rest of the Great Wheel. This conflict is called the Blood War. It's such a fundamental feature of Dungeons & Dragons mythology that it shows up in novels, comic books, even the Baldur's Gate and Neverwinter Nights games. Evil souls, when they die, like every petty necromancer a low-level adventuring party in a regular campaign might defeat, is condemned to fight as a foot soldier in the Blood War. If they wanted violence and death during their lives, they will get it in their afterlives, war never-ending at the mercy of sadistic monsters. But never-ending war is boring. Suppose you were a demon who craved variety. Fall from Grace is a succubus, but she's rebelled against the role the Great Wheel assigned her in every way possible. She has rebelled against the expectations of her form, taking a vow of chastity and even founding a self-described brothel for pleasures of thought and conversation. She is a demon who has compassion for mortal beings. She is a Tanari who tolerates the Betizu. Fall from Grace is the most robustly conflicted of the whole adventuring party, and it's remarked on by Ravel the Night Hag that her capacity for self-torment is tremendous. In the mythology of Dungeons & Dragons, beings of the planes don't have quite such a capacity for free will and self-transformation as mortal beings. They're born from the planes and represent the qualities of those places, the alignments, the intentions. To simply toss aside all the expectations of demonhood is a rare and a serious transgression against the order of the planes. The act of rebelling against her nature is something that will never find an actual resolution. It's a battle that Fall from Grace has to fight every day, will have to fight until she finally lets go and dies. Her friendship with the Nameless One is one of peers. They're both scarred, and they're both weary. All Fall from Grace really has to offer, besides being the party's cleric, is sympathy. But sympathy is quite a lot. Who can say they actually see the depth of 1,000 years' worth of misery and regret and no? Well, she can. Fall from Grace isn't transformed by her experience with the Nameless One like some of the other companions, but for a while, she has the company of someone else who appreciates the painful weight of having rejected what the multiverse demanded of you. Fall from Grace subscribes to the philosophy of the Sensates, one of many factions who vie for political power and sigil, but are internally defined by deep-rooted beliefs about the purpose and meaning of life. The Dustmen, for example, whose mortuary you wake up in, believe in the true death, that this world is already an afterlife and a punishment, and the goal is to get it over with and reach the eternal quiet of the true death. Not great at parties, the Dustmen. The Sensates believe that enlightenment will come to a being when they have experienced every sensation and experience, good or bad. They have a reputation in Sigil as being a bunch of rich hedonists trying to cosmologically justify having wine-fueled orgies, but there is more to it than that. The Civic Fest Hall has a sensorium, where the Sensates preserve small moments in glass balls and charge a small fee to access them. You can experience becoming a werebear in a moonlit glade, transformations rippling through your body, painful, exhilarating. You can experience slowly dawning horror, a wine lover drinking a vintage he realizes all too late will put him in thrall of the grinning vintner. They have the tedium of being in the classroom of the most boring professor in the multiverse, the agony of having your hand incinerated in lava, the tenderness of a first kiss. It's all available for a handful of copper coin at the public sensorium. But the Sensates themselves are the ones who go out and experience these things. Many of the stones contain painful, surprising deaths drained into the stone and made public. It's not hugely surprising, then, that all three of the sensory stones in the private wing of the sensorium have to do with you. The Nameless One, much more often for ill than good, has had more experiences than almost any other being. He's experienced the peaks and valleys of brilliance and madness, died a million awful deaths in a million angry places, gently pushed people and conversations and events in different directions, and changed the shape of the planes in doing so. He's been a sensate before, but for all that experience, he never did reach enlightenment, did he? In one of the stones, you meet a left-behind shadow of your paranoid incarnation, a twitchy murderer forever fleeing, forever on edge, refusing to trust the clues of his past and lashing out at any perceived threat in his presence. He left a trap for himself, thinking of past and future incarnations as body thieves. You can pester him with questions, though, and the shadow of the paranoid incarnation will eventually cast you out in an anxious fury over the idea of being trapped with your questioning gaze. He doesn't want to be seen, to be witnessed. He just wanted to hurt you before you even had the sliver of a chance of hurting him. This is an important experience to put in the stone, trap aside. Here you see that even if the body is immortal, the fragility of the mind is still a sad and inescapable reality. This old incarnation, who seems so vicious, is fundamentally just reacting badly to being frightened and confused every waking moment of his life, of your life. What was once can come around again and be so easily again. If you go to the tattoo parlor of a creature called Fel, you can ask Dakon to translate the rune language that Fel speaks. If you already know the language yourself, though, you find that Dakon is holding things back. The symbol of Torment, the recurring three-blade shape that you see over and over again in the game, is being discussed. Fel says that it draws people to the Nameless One, others who feel resonance with his pain, with his torment. He mentions the others who used to travel with you. Dakon is one of the only to ever return. The blind hunter Zachariah is another, a legendary fighter whose presence is only occasionally discussed in the game. He's really just one more dead man in the Nameless One's wake. But the other was a woman named Dianara, and one of the sensory stones in the private sensorium is hers. She was a young sensate who fell in love with the Nameless One. The Nameless One allowed her to do so, manipulated her to do so. But it was always his intention for her to die. The passage where the Nameless One, this incarnation, goes into Dianara's stone is one of the most powerful bits of writing in the game, and one of the things that makes Planescape Torment essentially timeless. It's a moment of pure horror and deep regret. It is the night that you convinced her to come to her death. You echo the words you said, you taste them coming out of your mouth, but you feel how she felt, the surge of emotions, the earnestness of her devotion. She believes that you loved her, but her belief is not enough. You remember the hollowness and the coldness that you felt, the irritation with her heartfelt affection, the incredible arrogance with which you looked at her and saw a disposable tool. To feel both sides of the conversation at the same time almost rips the Nameless One apart with regret. The writing here is urgent and raw and incredibly personal. It completely disregards any preconception of how RPG dialogue is supposed to be, how video game plots are supposed to work, in favor of something that forcefully and artistically is very awful and bleak. At the end of the game, you have an opportunity to speak to a representation of your very first incarnation, the one who started it all. He says that for him, it was regret that changed his nature. So seldom does a game aim to make the player feel a complex negative emotion, and I often think that this is what holds back a lot of video game writing, why video game writing has a reputation as being less serious than other mediums. Video games will often go for big, operatic moments of loss and grief, but they will almost never explore the tremendous damage that an empty promise and a misplaced trust can cause. The horror here is seeing yourself be a monster, to be powerless to stop any of the venomous words that are echoing here in the sensory stone, while for the first time truly learning how caustic the venom was. The past is the present here, and in that past you are inescapably, utterly cruel to someone who did nothing but love you. There is no choice but to bear witness to your own crime. What happy ending is there waiting for a man like this? Dianara's ghost is one of the first characters you encounter in the game. Her tomb is on the lower level of the mortuary. Her body was never recovered, but her father wanted to honor her just the same. You don't remember her, and it breaks her heart all over again. She loved you, she died for you, and you don't even have the decency to remember her sacrifice. There were others, too, lifetimes of emotional wreckage in the Nameless One's wake. Which is why the companion arc for Anna of Shadows is the weakest in the game, even if she's got one of the best-defined personalities of all the companion characters. Sigil, and a lot of Planescape, is characterized by a kind of slang called the chant. Voiced by Scottish actress Sheena Easton, Anna is a master of the chant. She helps sell the particulars of Sigil as a place by sounding like such a natural part of it. She is fiery, intensely competent, and incredibly rude to everyone in delightfully sarcastic ways. She's a part demon princess to a kingdom of trash at the center of the universe. But her own torment, her essential conflict that ties her to the other characters, is flatly that she loves the Nameless One even though he's fundamentally unlovable. As a romance, it happens too quickly to even be very perceptible. It's more like she has a strange crush on this smooth-talking, zombie-looking motherfucker she's been spending so much time with. A crush just doesn't seem like enough to cause her the kind of multi-layered pain that the other characters experience. But when the villain characters call out party members and name their hurts, Anna's hurt is clearly this romantic flame that she carries. It's one of those things that needed to be much more not at all for it to work in the game. There isn't a romance incorporated much into the script outside of a cute admission of feelings and a kiss and an optional dialogue. The whole adventure, in fact, takes place in the span of a couple weeks, maybe a little more than that if you're resting a lot of the Modron maze. There simply needed to be much more dialogue and much more time to give any kind of weight to this. And what weight there is ground covered in the character arcs of both Dianara and Ravel Puzzlewell. Anna is perceptive and has a keen sense of self-preservation, so you'd think that she'd be able to drop him like a hot rock, but she doesn't, and that's the source of her torment. It's a conventional conflict for a conventionally attractive character, which maybe only stands out on account of the setting and the general expectation for everything conventional to get tipped sideways when you're in Sigil. Romance gets uncomfortable when you start getting into the obsessive, unrequited love that Ravel the Night Hag has for the Nameless One. But you've got to go back further than that to get what Ravel's all about. Like Fall from Grace, she is being in tension with her nature. The Night Hags are demonic, hateful creatures who live in the Grey Wastes, the neutral evil plane between the Abyss and Baetor, where much of the Blood War is waged. There is a fatalism to the lower planes. They are forever in conflict by way of the natural order. To end the Blood War is to destroy the balance of the multiverse itself. Ravel is that rarest of monsters, the kind that dream of a different path. She believes that nothing, no being, should be chained to a destiny, to a place, to a rule. She is an absolute, cosmological anarchist. Many flattering things have been written about another one of Chris Avellone's creations, Kreia from Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic 2. She was a villain with a lot of truth and wisdom to impart, a rebel against the status quo, and Kreia was willing to destroy the Force itself if it meant that all creatures could be free to seek their independent destiny. Kreia is an incredible foil for the two-dimensional morality that can handicap a Star Wars story. But Ravel was the first interdimensional old lady anarchist in electronic role-playing, and she does an equally good job of humanistically dismantling the nine-point moral compass of the Dungeons & Dragons setting. Sigil is ruled by an enigmatic creature named the Lady of Pain. Any challenge to the major piece of Sigil is met with her blade's sharp gaze. Ravel had a plan well worthy of that gaze. She would open every portal, every door in Sigil at once, simultaneously. Anything gets in, anything gets out. Demons, angels, fire, flood, the vampire vacuum of the plane of negative energy and the radiant warmth of the positive. Absolute chaos. Terrible death. Terrible suffering. The total destruction of the city. But Ravel figured it was the Lady of Pain herself who was worth this destruction. To break the cage of the city would free the Lady of Pain. Ravel says, quote, I resent anyone, even a power, being imprisoned and think that all, everyone, whether stones, shores, or quiet bladed ladies, should be free. Long ago, the first incarnation of the Nameless One was a powerful wizard of terrible evil. He was destined to be cast down to the lower planes to fight the Blood War for all eternity as punishment for what he's done. He came to Ravel. He flattered her. He made her feel seen, feel wanted. And in return, Ravel looked at this mortal thing, trapped in the cage of its mortality and morality, and thought to herself that such a sweetly spoken creature should be free. She used her magic and wrenched you right apart from the mortal, vital essence of yourself. Now you were free, inside a hollowed-out shell that can never die and never find peace. When the Nameless One meets Ravel this time around, flattery will get you everywhere. You have to speak to her like she wants to be spoken to, how she wants to be seen, as if she actually was beautiful, either in body or spirit. She's neither, but her ugliness is sympathetic and complicated. She's a liar and a monster. Having eaten other mortals alive for pure sport, she once sent you a message by capturing a sensate, cutting off his arms and legs and tongue, and then sending him back to where he came from with a message for you to put in a sensory stone. But Ravel is completely genuine in her desire to break chains, completely brilliant in her understanding of magic and belief and the intertwining of the two. There are fragments of Ravel still out there in the real world, in Sigil. One is Mebeth, the one who taught you magic for the last time in what was an even older ritual than you knew. The two others are equally off-putting, strange, but ultimately helpful. A hag's kindness is worse than her cruelty, she cackles at you. Ravel is a wonderfully complex antagonist, full of surprise and depth. She was the one who set the Nameless One up for his lifetimes of pain and forgetting. But she didn't do it alone, or out of anger. You asked her to do it, and you talked her into loving you to get it done in some long-ago self that you no longer even remember at all. The Lady of Pain had trapped Ravel in a maze instead of killing her outright, perhaps in recognition of the fact that Ravel was, on some level, trying to do her a favor. Mazes are pocket planes, bubble realities from which there is always one escape, but not an escape you're likely to discover in a single lifetime. Luckily, the Nameless One has got a lot longer than that. There are several ways to anger the Lady of Pain throughout the game, like worshipping a god who was once banished from Sigil or going on a murder frenzy. The second time you piss off the lady, she kills you so hard it bumps you back a save game, but the first time, she banishes you to your own personal maze, moss-covered blocks suspended in darkness, with the mark of Torment seared in the middle. Out on one of the far platforms, you find a little camp and a journal made out of your own skin and bones, inked in your own blood. The skin pages are just a diversion, a red herring. They're written in nonsense. The real journal is concealed within a bone. This is a level of paranoia so intense that in a prison built only for you and containing no one else, you still hid your thoughts as deviously as you could. To protect them from yourself, you see. Your other selves, the past and future yous. The paranoid incarnation is one of the saddest. Like Ravel, he is entirely, inarguably, murderously insane. He's also the one who got you those tattoos. He didn't have those tattoos. He woke up with no context, just the angry ghost of Dianara calling him a betrayer, just the shadows seeking him out and striking when he's weak, just a parade of faces who see him and recognize someone he knows he is not. It broke him. He coped by lashing out at every single perceived threat, real or imagined. You get to know this incarnation well through his hidden journals. Another journal you find in the Hall of Sensates, in a room that you were informed was already yours. They told him the same thing, and he set up shop there years ago, as willing to accept a convenient windfall as you are now. To keep his secrets from you, he seeks out one of Sigil's all-round nicest guys, Phenom the Linguist. Phenom patiently taught you the most obscure language known in the multiverse, the language of Uyo. Phenom is the last in the multiverse to speak it, until your welcome interest. When your training is over, you strangled the guy. Now, years later, his ashes sit on his son's mantelpiece. Using a skill you learned from a zombie, you can speak with the ashes. You can remember what you did to Phenom, and you can apologize to him, long after his death. Phenom will remind you of what you've forgotten if you do so. This is pretty typical of quest progression in this game. It's kind of kaleidoscopic, with many different threads of plot weaving together into surprisingly coherent patterns that shift meaning when seen from different angles of time and understanding. At the very end of the game, you can speak the language of Uyo to calm a manifestation of your paranoid incarnation. You can fight him, sure, that's one option, but if you speak the language of Uyo to him, you can instead have empathy for him, for yourself, for knowing that for all the murdering, what he fundamentally wanted was to be safe and to be quiet. He surrenders himself to your incarnation's psyche, and he finds that peace at last. This is what makes the writing in Planescape Torment so ultimately timeless, so uniquely good. It's a unified artistic front. The setting is full of the symbols of the storytelling leverages the exoticism of the setting, the exoticism of the setting comes from exaggerating the symbolism of the story. Every element of theme and tone interlock and support each other. The mark of any truly masterful piece of art, no matter what medium, is a natural and thorough unification of structure, style, and purpose. A truly great book or play has a similar sense of each scene, each interaction, no matter how trivial, building up to a climax that reflects something backward on all of it. It's all curated towards producing a genuine reflection in the audience about the questions being artistically posed. A criticism of games as an artistic medium often centers around how choice dilutes an artistic message, which is more linearly communicated in passive art like movies. Planescape Torment makes the fact that the player can choose, that they are complicit in a life that is not their own, the fulcrum of the way it makes its emotional impact. Sure, the whole amnesiac protagonist is an ancient cliché, but the player's arc of understanding, both in regards to the game world and in regards to their past selves, mirrors the player character's perspective one for one. You are absolutely walking that path together, in a way that even PC as a player avatar games such as Baldur's Gate sometimes struggle to convey. When the whole point of a quest is to rid a cave of orcs, it is cool to be able to roll the dice and do that, but when the point of a quest is to hear the stories of people who you slowly learn you've hurt and damaged in the past and then figure out how to make amends to them, then this is something more immediately relatable and vivid, no matter how exotic the setting. Much of fantasy is just that, a kind of much elaborated daydream about places and experiences we'll never see and never have. Slaying the dragon is, no question, an important part of Dungeons & Dragons. But Torment, for all its fantasy trappings, is much more about reality. It is much more about sadness, regret, forgiveness. And I mean true forgiveness, where it isn't deserved and everyone knows it, but it's given anyway, and not lawful good. I think you've learned your lesson here, villain! Pontificating. Video games, even this one, are on some level always escapist. The thing that holds back a lot of fantasy writing is in extending that escapism farther than it has to go, into self-aggrandizement and broad power fantasy. That can be fun, and often is, but it also makes it emotionally weightless. You are always going to win if you put in the time to finish in an arc like that. Planescape Torment flips the paradigm. You are on a self-critical journey to confront yourself and pay for your crimes. Here, winning is undoing all that you had done in previous lives. It's hard to call something escapist when the clear message is that you cannot run or hide from your own past, though you may eventually find forgiveness and closure for it. I was driving through Wyoming once with my wife and our dogs, and we were all listening to the podcast where LeVar Burton reads short stories, and he read an especially melancholy and beautiful one called Navigators by Mike McGuinness. The description simply says it's about a father and son playing a video game together, as bland a description as saying Torment is an RPG about a very old wizard. The game the father and son play in Navigators is called Legend of Silence, a strange dungeon crawl game where the main character, a royal bird woman with beautiful wings, a powerful sword, and even a gun, must give up some element of her strength to progress. Metal boots weigh her down. She will never fly again, but she can reach the bottom of a pit she couldn't before. Her sword becomes broken. Her body becomes frail. The dungeon stays as it had before. The monsters the same level of challenge. Where they had started out attacking the monsters, by the end of the game, all the father and son are able to do is hobble frantically away. Together, they're making a map of the dungeon on graph paper, the father showing the son how best he knows to make sense of their path through the game. But things at home are not well. The father loves the son loves the father, and they are both absolutely fascinated with this strange game of disempowerment. But meanwhile, bills pile up, garbage piles up. The boy's mother calls, but can't be persuaded to speak with him, won't even speak to the father for more than a minute. The game goes on. The father and son move to a smaller apartment. The father is doing his best, but he is failing himself and failing his family. The love is real, the love is meaningful, but the situation is lonely and bleak. So they escape into the game. Only to have the game simply underline what they already know. That life gets more painful the deeper in you go. That the things you find can be lost again. That every armor crumbles to dust, and at some point you'll find that you can't even fight the monsters anymore. There will come a time when you are not just left with nothing at all, but when you will be nothing at all entirely. I wasn't ready for this kind of story, I wasn't expecting it, and I was defenseless against it. When it ended, my wife turned to me and said, "Are you okay?" And I discovered that I wasn't. I was crying, and when I tried to answer, I found I couldn't. I didn't have any words. I had to stop and pull over the bus. I had never heard a story that could have been about my own childhood before, not in such a particularly specific way. I'd never heard anyone try and articulate that kind of desolate, lonely childhood misery that pools and steams in the world outside video games, and how video games can feel more real in trying to escape from it. And how, ultimately, they offer no true escape. That every electronic world I saved as a kid was a reminder that my own was still broken. Planescape Torment isn't as explicit as Legend of Silence and its disempowerment, but they share a core disinterest in escapism as a design virtue. At the end of Planescape Torment, there's a moment where you can finally unlock the power of a mysterious bronze sphere that you've been carrying around the whole game. It's a sensory stone from your first incarnation. It holds his regret. The regret that changed his nature. When the Nameless One holds the spear, it dissolves into thousands upon thousands of tiny droplets that run up his arms and burrow into his skin, each a memory, each a regret, each a moment of pain he could have prevented had he been willing to be a better person. I like to think of myself as having gotten over my childhood, but a lot of it seems to have been time and forgetting doing their work, and not me personally. I felt stupid and pathetic, completely undone on the side of the road from having listened to the man from Reading Rainbow read me a more serious story. But it was like the sensory stone. There were so many moments that I had omitted, forgotten, suppressed, memories of being alone, truly alone among my mother's junk hoard, in a dark house of cardboard boxes stretching up to the ceiling, and the smell of rotting garbage from every direction. The memories ran up my arms and burrowed into my skin, and it was as if someone had cut all the cords keeping my brain together, and it simply fell apart into mush. No walls, no thought, just the memory and the emotion as if there wasn't 21 years of living in between then and now at all. I have been many different versions of myself. Some are long forgotten, but they are not gone. It might be a LeVar Burton podcast, or it might be a mysterious bronze sphere that smells like custard, but there are things in the world that can cause a cascade of remembering so intense that it changes you all over again. Planescape might be fantasy in its setting, but its truths are mine as well, and I've judged them to be real enough. The final guiding principle of the Planescape setting is the unity of rings, the idea that most things in life and death and in between are cyclical, that the end is the beginning is the end. The Great Wheel is that way. A journey across all the planes will lead you right back to the beginning again when you're done. Sigil is like the inside of a tire, forever rotating on the axle of the Outland Spire. And the room you wake up in at the beginning of Planescape Torment is the room containing the portal that leads directly to your lost mortality. All you have to do is name a regret, and the portal will open to a place that is, literally and figuratively, a fortress of them. In Dungeons & Dragons cosmology, the negative energy plane is where pure decay emanates from, the energy that animates skeletons, zombies, vampires, liches, all the undead, originates there on that plane. Nothing solid can last long, its power of entropy is literally bottomless. But the Nameless One's mortality hides here, in a castle fortress forged like the cities of Dakon's people, built of thought. In this case, it's all those lifetimes of regret. And it's filled with dangerous shadows, the shades of those who have died in your place. It's a late-game revelation that every time the Nameless One cheats death, another simply pays the price for him, a life sucked out of some unsuspecting nobody from the Prime Material Plane and given to you instead. It puts a lot in perspective, because the in-game mechanical ritual of dying during the infrequent combat becomes routine. The only setback is temporal and spatial. You have to work your way back to where you were before, but all is otherwise as it had been, no reloading of the game needed. Every time you casually shrugged your shoulders and delighted in the convenience of all this as a player, you knew also that it meant little to the Nameless One as a character. You die 5 times in a row as part of the solution to one puzzle in this game. It becomes a thoughtless thing, an accepted part of the scenario. This kind of twist resonates with the player and the player character both, because it causes each to go back and begin to calculate the hidden cost of these experiences. How many deaths? How many tickets voided out just so you could ride again for free? Part of the fantasy of D&D role-playing is that, generally, your free will counts for almost everything. If you seek to do good, and act to do good, you will have done good, and vice versa for evil. Neutrality is trickier, but the emphasis will still have been on intention and choice. Planescape Torment is taking an extremely contradictory storytelling perspective by making it so fundamentally clear that even if you had intended to do good, acted to do good, you will still have done wrong on a fundamentally unavoidable level. You were damned for what you did in the first place, and the loss of your mortality has simply damned you a different way at the continuing cost of other people's lives. When you meet that third incarnation, the original incarnation, he'll tell you flat that all his kindness and goodness was done in an attempt at redemption that was ultimately futile. He forgot all about his regrets, and he became someone much worse again. But now you. You can do what the other incarnations could not. You can die for real, at last, and begin to pay the metaphysical debt that you've accrued across the vastness of time. Your triumph is not to win, but to close the painfully open loop of yourself, to restore the unity of yourself, and fulfill the unity of rings. And that is how you arrive at a climax where the player's character, who you have spent 30 hours or more in the shoes of, ends up quite literally going to hell to suffer for all eternity, and it is not only the best ending, but a deeply satisfying one all around. It's worth visiting the tremendous variety of climactic choice at the end, however, because it is unusually remarkable. The endings where you actually fight a boss fight are something like 2 of 8 possibilities. The others are so satisfying and creative that it is tough to choose just one. One of the more boring ones has you using a blade of pure entropic chaos forged for you by a golem whose goal is to destroy the multiverse, to sever your connection to any kind of living at all, annihilating you and your mortality and any trace of your being at all. Outside of the lives you've touched, anyway. A better ending is using Ravel's question offensively. Ask your immortality what can change the nature of a man. You'll go through a litany of your adventures, elaborating what was the moral all along. It is belief that can change the nature of a man. It is belief that can alter the face of the planes themselves. It is belief that you are stronger, belief that you can put back what was split from you, that will allow you to actually be stronger and remake yourself into a mortal creature. Since this is an RPG still, there's an attribute check involved in getting away with that one, but it's narratively perfect. Even if it's not the ending you choose, it's still fundamentally a truth of the story that's been told, something woven throughout each encounter you have from the most cursory to the seemingly endless. My preferred ending is the one involving the bronze sphere. There's something else that comes back to you alongside the source of your torment, that geyser of forgotten regret. Your name. In a brilliant creative choice, the name is not given to the player. It's not significant to the player, not really. It's significant to the player character. It's significant because he is no longer the Nameless One, and that significance is too private to convey with a name drawn from a hat. How flat would it be to reveal that this whole time he was Paul, or maybe Howard? It truly doesn't matter compared to what it means to him. He has the whole of himself, the setup, the context, and now, within reach after millennia of being lost in confusion, the resolution. If he knows his name, his mortality is nothing. It is not a separate thing. It is part of him again already. It does not know its name. It does not remember. If you share it, there is nothing other than to become whole again, now that you both know the separation between you was always just waiting to be disbelieved. Fighting out the boss fight is fun as a mage, because you can use all those level 9 spells that are so overpowered and absurd that you're restricted to this last minute to use them, but a contest of wills and a brawl is a poor substitute for a moment of recognition and absolution, powerful enough to subdue a creature of magical wrath as powerful as your lost mortality. It is a stronger thing not to have needed to demonstrate the strength in the first place, to have instead arrived back at the whole of yourself with grace. As a final act, you raise your companions from the dead and say your goodbyes. Dakon is free from you, and free in himself. Mort has done right by you, can feel right about himself for having done so. Anna will be fine, stronger and richer for her time with you. Nordum has learned his new name as well as you've remembered yours, and Fall from Grace promises to visit you in hell when she has the time. You fall dead, truly dead for the last time. The Named One finds himself in hell, reaches for a nearby mace, and ambles his way into the blood war and his eternal punishment with a confident stride. And why not? What terror could hell offer that compares with the torment of endless forgetting, endless sorrow? The steps that the Named One takes onto the battlefields of the Blood War are the first steps that that man has taken forward in his existence for uncounted eons, and a better ending for the game I could not possibly imagine. So, how precisely do you follow up the saddest choose-your-own-adventure novel ever written? The process was much complicated by the fact that the Planescape setting was canonically wound down and discontinued with the 1998 adventure module Faction War. Faction War is what it says on the tin. The factions attempt to overthrow the Lady of Pain and are widely disbanded. In 3rd edition Dungeons & Dragons and later, Planescape cosmology and setting fixtures like Sigil were still supported in supplemental materials, but it was never its own thing again after Advanced Dungeons & Dragons wound to a close. So, right there, you've got a legal and business nightmare on the front of using Planescape as part of the branded material. But even if they could do another Planescape game, Torment was a singular story, with no interest in providing room for a spinoff. It used its resources to tell the stories it needed to tell for its own themes, its own plot. It left nothing for a sequel to latch onto. Besides, of course, the City of Doors, the promise of a multiverse where anything can happen and likely already is. That feeling of limitless creative possibility in the setting, and being able to use geography and mythology to map out the symbolic beats of the story, that was still ripe for the taking. But it just couldn't be Planescape, for reasons completely arbitrary to the storytelling potential of the setting. So they went with something else designed by Mont Cook, one of the original guys behind Planescape. Numenera is a setting that takes place in the extreme far future, with civilization after civilization stacked on top of each other and the technology of a million different places over a million different years all commingling in a heap of history and oddity. It's neither science fiction all the way or fantasy all the way. It's actually a pastiche that evens out to what Kroll might have looked like if it had been directed by Terry Gilliam. Developed by Brian Fargo's InExile Entertainment, Torment Tides of Numenera is a game that finds itself in as much of a conflict over its essential nature as any companion from the original game. On the one hand, it's a vivid introduction to the setting of Numenera, with a new rule set that introduces a more gamified conversation system, and a turn-based crisis mode for combat and other hostile situations. This system mimics a tabletop combat resolution more faithfully than anything since the Infinity Engine days, but even more nakedly on account of the removal of real-time with pause in favor of a true turn-by-turn system that gives individual initiative roles to every character every turn. The ways in which it breaks with its predecessor and pursues a separate but complementary set of artistic ambitions are the areas in which the game is strongest, but the burden of expectation as a sequel to a game that had no other true imitators in the nearly 20 years since its release was massive, and the writers often engaged with the pressure of that legacy in underwhelmingly derivative ways. This ambition to copy certain elements one for one from the original leads to a story that has a familiar, predictable rhythm, in a world hand-tailored to be as imaginatively expressive and surprising as possible. It's an irresolvable tension, a conflict over the thing's very nature. I found that conflict ultimately more memorable than the narrative one. The tension can be best and most immediately seen in the plot's setup. There's an ancient and selfish being called the Changing God, who, through his mastery of technology and a power called the Tides, has found a way to fashion immortal shells to dump the essence of his being into. When convenient or when necessary for his survival, the Changing God will occasionally dump a body, who then begins a life of their own. It's a little like Doctor Who if the older Doctors became entirely new characters each time there was a new Doctor. The changing god, and all the many cast-offs he has left in his wake, are all being pursued by an implacable and Lovecraftian being called the Sorrow. If this sounds a little familiar, get used to it. Echoes of the original game's motifs and themes are everywhere, just slightly altered. The problem here is the malleability of blame, and the relative softness of the player's connection to that blame. In Planescape Torment, the incarnations of the Nameless One were, very significantly, all simply expressions of a single consciousness, a fallible mortal in an immortal's body, whose multiple selves were all sewn tightly together in experience and characterization. To pay for the crimes of the first incarnation as the last incarnation felt right at the end because you were looping the loop, bringing closure to a wound in the world that you couldn't grasp the dimensions of early on in the game. Here, you can claim to really be the changing god, and even absorb his essence at the end of the game if you believe that forcefully enough, but it is demonstrable that you are separate beings, separate minds, and although there is an entire skill tree in the game dedicated to remembering things from the past lives of the changing god, your present course is no one's but your own, and it's for that that you'll ultimately be judged. It's a change that puts emphasis back on the player and the player's directorial ability, as opposed to the mostly linear character arc of the Nameless One. Over and over, Torment Tides of Numenera preferences player choice over novelistic certainty. It's a trade-off that, on paper, is a positive thing. More agency. How can that be bad? Well, it's missing the melancholy fatalism that was so central to the tone of the original game. The Nameless One had been through this mystery many times, sometimes reaching the very end before forgetting and falling back down to the beginning again. It's not a question of ability in reaching the end, it's a question of meaning. What can the Nameless One do differently this time to make the journey matter, to make its consequences permanent? You were doomed. Much of the game's plot was simply finding a way to accept being doomed. To have designed the game with the principle of unity of rings in mind led to something a little stranger and a little more emotionally forceful and resonant than an average adventure. Yet, average adventure is the setup and execution here. You are not an amnesiac, not truly, you're simply a brand new person, a blank slate, a character sheet waiting to be filled. What follows will be, for better or worse, a classic adventure of the novice becoming a master and confronting the big bads no matter the exoticism of the setting. This allows much, much more personalization on the player side of the equation than Planescape Torment, but it also saps the game of a lot of its melancholy. Why would you feel sorry for a character who's always done what you've told them to do, who's always been who you wanted them to be? The Numenera setting is, in general, a little brighter and a little louder than Planescape. It's such a deliberate mashup of genre and expectations that it lacks the kind of mythological consistency that Planescape had. Planescape was allegorical. When talking about a plane, you were talking about its characteristics, its alignment, its thematic intent. It's a valid criticism to say that Planescape is too allegorically on the nose like that, wearing its metaphors so freely and openly, but the fact is that this is such a low-key, pervasive feature lurking behind every landscape and every quest that it gives questing in the setting a unique kind of weight. Campaigns in Planescape don't have to stop and set up these allegorical parallels. These parallels emerge naturally from the dictates of the adventure at hand. The ninth world of Numenera, however, offers nothing so cosmologically tidy as the Great Wheel of Planescape. The only limit is the dungeon master's imagination, and so the setting can be used to tell any kind of story, every kind of story. It is a creative tool of infinite quirkiness whose only real demand is that you get as weird with it as possible. Tides of Numenera is a phenomenal introduction to the setting, and I feel as fluent in Numenera and its tones and intentions as I did with Planescape after playing that game for the first time. It's a hook that shows you how powerful of a storytelling tool that setting can be once you've got a handle on the vibe. There's a strong sentiment in user reviews for Tides of Numenera that it's somehow too much of a lore dump for its setting, that it spends too much time explaining itself and its world. But the original game was very much like that too, even going so far as to have a map primarily featuring three lecture halls with extremely in-depth discussions of setting cosmology. I didn't feel like the amount of exposition was any different between the two games, but on account of the differences in setting, the curation of the exposition was much changed. Each of the lectures in the lecture hall in Planescape Torment somehow reflected directly back on the Nameless One's journey, even hinting at revelations that happened much later on. In Numenera, storytelling is often done for the sake of storytelling alone. There are dozens of characters who tell dozens of stories that are surprising and detailed, well worth listening to, but they reflect on the setting, not the journey. They show how wild and strange the broader world is beyond the story you're experiencing. They don't nearly as often illustrate some facet of your own character. This is, again, because there is deliberately less distance between player and player character. The last cast-off is much more of an avatar for the real human behind the glowing screen than the Nameless One ever was. In isolation, either the looser symbolic construction of the setting or the widened agency of the player would be less noticeable and more welcome. But because this is branded principally as a spiritual sequel to Torment and not an independent Numenera adventure, the two of them together create a noticeably different feel from the original Torment game that leaves a stronger impression of difference the deeper into the game you get. The differences in tone and intent between Numenera and Planescape are more difficult to articulate than their similarities, despite the importance of those differences in how the game comes across. But the best place to see those differences working is with a mechanic in the game called mirror casting. Mirror casters are objects that allow the last cast-off to experience moments in the lives of other cast-offs and incarnations of the Changing God, and in some minor ways alter the outcome if you're clever enough to get to the end of the memory without dying or being critically sidetracked. They are, explicitly, choose-your-own-adventure stories within a choose-your-own-adventure story, illustrated with drawings and filled with choices that have screen-by-screen consequence, leading to hugely divergent outcomes that have, ultimately, little bearing on your own incarnation and your own struggles. The purpose is purely expressive, a strange vignette from a strange world the developers would have no budget to ever graphically portray in the game otherwise. The mirror casters, more than anything else in the game, underline the tremendous density of age and experience in the setting, time going backwards so far that you lose sight of any beginning or end, just an endless parade of civilizations rising and falling, of life in all its variety and emotion. The mirror casters are what's best about Numenera as a setting, a chance to go truly wild with creating mental images, anything from a world of inverted pyramids rotating slowly in the air under a blood-red sun of some distant solar system to a world of bucolic splendor protected by swarms of nanorobots, or a psychic amplifier the size of a city that over millennia becomes a city. Anything you can conceive, it will fit. It is not a city of doors, but instead an open plain of imagination, open to travel any direction your whims will take you. They're like the sensory stones of the last game, but way more complicated and participatory. It's a chance to be characters beyond your character, little tastes of the Changing God and the cast-off's fractal lives. Therein lies the narrative problem. You're a tourist in these spaces. Time and space contort and rush to accommodate your voyeuristic curiosity. It's a setting that fundamentally has a kind of breathless enthusiasm to it. It is made to be dived into headfirst, a rush of experience that would make a sensate blush. However, mythology this malleable makes it harder to have an introspective personal story without the symbolic structure of the other planes. The environment and the themes are no longer bound to one another by design. For example, the Changing God's cast-offs, being mostly immortal themselves, have begun fighting an endless battle between those loyal to the Changing God and those who have come to despise him, led by the very first cast-off. It resembles, for all intents and purposes, the Blood War, and its all-encompassing destructiveness hangs over you like the previous threat of damnation in Planescape Torment. It's not a cosmological feature like the Blood War, however. It is not a necessary part of the game world, and so it feels wasteful, foolish, frustrating. The Changing God and the cast-offs are certainly selfish for engaging in such a war, using less durable mortals as cannon fodder for their ancient weapons of terrible power. This is a legacy that your character inherits, and something will eventually have to be done about it, but it is hard to say what it all really means to the last cast-off. It's entirely possible, and maybe even easy, to not care about the Changing God's war at all. There are, after all, a million different worlds with a million different stories all happening at the same time. Although your character has a special destiny, the impact of that special destiny plot is much reduced by the sheer creative scale of the setting of Numenera itself. In Planescape, you had a personal introspective journey taking place in a defined and organized cosmos. In Tides of Numenera, you have a world-shaking level of importance and impact in a setting so chaotically vast it's hard to say if your world-shaking will even be heard over all the other racket. There are as many similarities to Baldur's Gate as there are to Planescape Torment in Tides of Numenera, so when you consider how deliberately different those two older games were in structure and approach, the awkwardness of their mixed styles here in the newer game comes into greater focus. Like Baldur's Gate, the emphasis in Tides is on a protagonist who stands in for the player, a protagonist with a special divine destiny, some unique power to reshape the world to come depending on choices made along the way. But consider the differences in pacing between the two games. Tides of Numenera is about 40 hours, and not altogether very much of it concerns the Changing God directly. It is much more about the world of Numenera, about being that stranger in a strange land. When the climax kicks in, it kicks in tough, but it feels like relatively little was done to build up to it by the time you get there. It's just the final confrontation with the Changing God and the sorrow that you've been anticipating since the beginning of the game. In Baldur's Gate, discovering that you are the child of the Lord of Murder is the big reveal of the first game, a whole 40-hour adventure in itself. You get to know the world and your party as a regular adventure before being saddled with your divine destiny. And then it escalates and scales. The second Baldur's Gate began with you being targeted for your divine legacy, and ends with you using that legacy to survive hell itself. Then the expansion, Throne of Baal, finally began to regard the player character as powerful and important beyond the scope of a regular mortal character, showing that your power and fame have made impossible the quaint heroics of the first game, or even the second. By the time you get to that throne, after anywhere from 1 to 200 hours of play, the question of how you want to use your divine power, whether you accept or reject godhood itself, seems like the true climax of the whole experience, the mountaintop of a peak built out of dozens and dozens and dozens of hours of fighting and questing and talking and bartering. In Planescape Torment, you did heal a wound in the universe, but that's secondary to the act of having healed yourself. True to the center of all principle, it did not matter if the world revolved around you, because the story would still do so anyway. In Tides of Numenera, using the kind of epic, extroverted narrative structure of Baldur's Gate with the pacing and tonality of Planescape Torment is a mashup that doesn't feel right even in the creative chaos of the Ninth World. To figure out how to do another amnesiac immortal is tough, but that's not where they should have even started. The root of Torment the game is Torment the emotion. They should have started with character, with a painful flaw, an open wound in the protagonist that the game's narrative can heal. But they oriented this new torment with the head and not the heart, and so we wind up with a frustratingly hollow impact in the Changing Gods' immortal legacy. The other disconnect between being a Torment game and being a Numenera game is in the difference between telling a focused story and a multiplicity of stories. I said earlier that Planescape Torment was more curated towards its very specific thematic goals, and nowhere better can you see that than in the companions. In Tides of Numenera, they have no unifying theme. Instead, following the standard, "I'll tell you about my past if you help me with a fetch quest" companion format that's standard to nearly every Western RPG. Each is interesting enough, but none so memorable as the cast of the original Torment. Lacking a unifying connection to the protagonist, they feel auxiliary to the last cast off instead. You have a lot more going on than they do, and their struggles are peculiar anyway. One companion, Algern, thinks he destroyed his family with a strange artifact, only to discover that his family had become the strange tattoos on his arm that he thought commemorated their deaths. Callista, the other starting companion, can sense other versions of herself in other universes, and their differing experiences and contradictory emotions make it hard for her to develop her own individual voice in the world outside of the collective of herself. Having spent a sentence on each character, I don't really need to spend very much more. It's not that these characters are poorly written, it's simply that in a world of endlessly extraordinary things, these are just two more stories in a game full to bursting with them. You'll hear life stories and character arcs equally as complex among the NPCs who don't follow you around. Sometimes these stories benefit from being ongoing companion quests, like with Eretus. You find him having stolen and crashed an airship in a botched and boneheaded attempt at heroism. He's a fantasy-setting-styled warrior who loves justice and smashing, a Minsk without the accent and the hamster. Later, though, you find a little alcove with an empty box and a shepherd's crook. Eretus is terrified of it all for some reason. It turns out that Eretus was just a farm boy once who lost a sheep and curled up in that alcove to sleep. In the night, the box opened. Inside was a swarm of machine intelligences that possessed him and compelled him to literally play the hero, to adhere to the cliché of the adventuring hero for the amusement and satisfaction of the machine demon. You are eventually able to bargain with the machine demon to either let him alone or double down, burning up his body and his mind and pushing him to greater and greater feats of bravery and strength. It's very, very Numenera, a fantasy concept with a sci-fi twist that subverts the cliché. But what does this have to do with the last cast-off specifically? Well, nothing. But it sure is neat, isn't it? Storytelling in Numenera is a mosaic of little moments and little stories that, when viewed from farther away, creates an impression of a much greater whole, the mosaic of the Ninth World. But the storytelling in the first Torment game was much more deliberate and structural, each character, each conversation, a brick in the path that could only ever lead to the Fortress of Regrets. Those two approaches were well unified in another isometric revival RPG, Tyranny. Tyranny had as much of an emphasis on player agency and providing the player with meaningfully branching story choices as Tides of Numenera, and it also had as much of an interest in heavy-duty world-building, introducing players to a totally new fantasy setting with a very particular approach to morality and magic that's very different from both D&D's Nine Point Compass or Numenera's Colored Tides. But, like Planescape Torment, it was all curated to produce a specific thematic result, whatever choice a player ends up making. Its world, its peoples, its particulars, they were all built from the ground up to get the player thinking on the things the game wants to talk about. Your mechanical agency was balanced with intense narrative pressure to conform and comply with what's expected of you. The stories the characters tell you in Tyranny reflect on the complexity of the choices you are yet to make in the coming miles of your journey. You have special abilities and experience a rise to power, but that rise is tempered by a world that contextualizes the power within a wider, more complex whole. In Tides of Numenera, decontextualization is part of the whole vibe of the setting, as important as a dungeon is to Dungeons & Dragons. Here, picking through a pile of trash can yield a battered helmet. If you put the helmet on, just for fun, it activates. It shows you an archived video loop of an important discovery that had to be verified by a mainframe, but never had the chance to. Elsewhere, there is a space station where society has waited for thousands of years for a ship to come and take them home to their fabled home world. Most believe the ship will never come. Elsewhere, a con man living inside an interdimensional creature called the Bloom that holds a flesh labyrinth with towns and people and such in it wants you to steal that navigation computer by going through a dimensional portal in one of the creature's many gaping maws. During the heist, you discover that you can interface that old helmet with the navigational computer and verify its footage. That footage shows that the Ninth World, where you come from, is their long-lost homeworld. So all of these people can stop waiting and just follow you through the portal, their people's long ordeal at an end. So you call off the heist and tell them, at which point they just give you the navigation computer anyway because they don't really need it anymore. So you take that back to the con man, and he trades a Mirrorcaster to you for it. With Mirrorcaster, you can experience an all-new, completely unrelated adventure from a distant where and when. I cannot stress enough that this is an actual, factual quest progression in Torment Tides of Numenera. Stories and images and ideas all spun around in the machine on permanent press tumble dry. Stories whose reward is more stories. If the pervasive theme of the setting is exuberant chaos and exhausting detail, it is pretty much impossible to guide the player toward any kind of thematic conclusion or unifying concept. Agency and choice take the place of contemplative fatalism. Makes for a rousing adventure, but missing from the picture are the sharp, jagged edges that tatter the player's expectations of being in control at all, that cut out the escapist heart of the fantasy to show it to you, still beating, and ask if it looks familiar. The game's called Torment, and I'm having entirely too good a time with it for that title to be accurate. There is a character arc for a companion character that positively illustrates the specific kind of approach that makes the Numenera setting sing. A slaver in the city of Saugus Cliffs, a city that the Changing God built from the ground up thousands of years ago, wants you to find a child. Her name is Riss. You find Riss hiding in a collapsed building. She asks to come with you and fills a party member slot as a full NPC, but she's still a kid, she isn't very mechanically useful, and having her in the party is deliberately sacrificing an important narrative and tactical resource. Now, earlier in the game, you meet a different kid in the marketplace who, when you asked him what's good in the city, rattled off a list of landmarks that hadn't actually existed in Saugus Cliffs for hundreds of years. If you press the couple taking care of him, they admit that they aren't his real parents and that he comes from the capital letter E elsewhere, another time when Saugus Cliffs was poorer and more desperate. His parents pushed him into an ancient portal artifact called the Door of Empty Time. There's a network of people, it turns out, dedicated to watching the portal and finding homes for the orphans that pop out of it. For hundreds and hundreds of years in this town, parents who don't want or can't take care of their kids have been sending them blindly into the future, hoping a friendly face will meet them there. This charity for temporally displaced orphans is called the House of Empty Time. You can send Riss through it if you like, and if you think it'll help, but she trusts you. She says she doesn't want to go through the door. So, do you listen to the useless child who's become your responsibility, or not? If you do listen to her, much, much, much later you come to the Bloom, the transdimensional flesh labyrinth. There is a man there with a portal in his chest, like a wound that opens and closes as a doorway. On the other side, Riss glimpses something. Her home. Her true home. Like many of the characters of Planescape, Riss accidentally wandered off from her home and into a door that brought her here, to this confusing and unkind place. At this point, she's probably become the party's healer, and so letting her go with no easy replacement is yet another tactical sacrifice. But it's her home. It's her destiny. She deserves to go. Riss carves a little totem she calls gods, insists that they're real and powerful. She gives you one and says that if you truly need help, she'll know. Hours later, you're at the game's climax, a portal opens, and in steps Riss, but not the girl you looked after. A skilled warrior and leader in her 30s. It's been years in her world. You were her childhood savior, the one who plucked her out of slavery and helped her find her way home, no matter how impossible or hopeless that felt at the time. And now, in your time of need, she's returned. Her god told her so, like she knew he would. And so the roles have reversed. She is here to take care of you. It is you who are lost and fragile, and her shoulder given for the party to lean on. The affection and the history between Riss and the last cast-off is real and tangible, but it's something that developed over the course of the game, not a history reaching back before the beginning. By preferencing the player's journey over the player characters in the narrative, these moments of long history and deep connection can only surface after a substantial amount of game time has passed, after the player has forged these connections manually themselves. It's not like with Dianara and the Nameless One, whose past is much deeper than what's shown in the game. It's a fact of pacing and structure that Baldur's Gate or Mass Effect leveraged powerfully in their final installments. Torment Tides of Numenera has too much work to do introducing a complicated world and giving opportunity to let the player characterize their avatar for that kind of long-form connection. Planescape got off easier because so much of it was already expected to be half understood by the player, at least. Worlds of angels and devils and riotous in-betweens that are recognizable if you've ever played Dungeons & Dragons before. The Nameless One was not beginning his journey, but ending it instead. This time, in Tides of Numenera, the story begins, effectively, when the game begins, with your blank slate birth of consciousness. The past is just so much empty time to such a fresh-faced beginner as the last cast-off. The new system of leveling and advancement also exists in tension with the epic scope of the story. Every level always costs 160 experience points, no matter how deep in the game you go, giving you more and more power quicker at the end of the game instead of slowing you down like a scaling experience system such as D&D. Mostly, this system is built to acknowledge that the bulk of the game takes place within dialogue trees, and so allows you to spend effort points in matters of the mind, matters of speed, and matters of strength to add a higher likelihood to your success attempt. In the early game, this feels important and dire. The skill pools are limited and resting is expensive, so you end up taking chances on something with a 65-55% chance of success and spend all your effort on even getting the percentage there in the first place. It feels like a real effort. It feels like a real risk. The failures highlight the gravity of the skill checks, and the successes feel, therefore, more meaningful. As you gain power, you become more relaxed. You can go deeper into conversations and have more encounters before getting bottomed out on your points pools. It's a quality of life improvement, a player convenience by the mid-game. But after you hit Tier 4 or 6, or the 16th level, your abilities in various areas and skill check bonuses are so high that, coupled with stat pools so deep you'll never see the bottom of them, there is no reason not to expect a 95% chance of success even on things you didn't start out trying to get your character good at. Tides of Numenera can have you going hours and hours and hours without seeing any combat at all, and so outside of your own personal investment in the world's storytelling and the choices that you make in it, these skill checks are the only unpredictable mechanical interaction you have with the game for long stretches of time, the only gamified part of what you're doing. To reach a point where you lose the unpredictability of those interactions makes them feel unremarkable, just one more dialogue option as opposed to a risky alternative choice. To reach a point where your character is just generally good at whatever thing they choose to do is to reach a point where you become like the Changing God, arrogantly aloof from mortal concerns. The riotous exoticism of the setting loses a bit of its edge if you feel too powerful to be brought low and fucked up by it. Numenera seems to me like it works best having the player be just one more face in the crowd, one of a million stories, no more important, no less. This whole business with destiny and divine legacy and a never-ending war that you eventually decide the fate of, this gives the player too much narrative power. The way the player gains ability through the leveling system to become, eventually, totally out of step with the challenges of the world, gives the player too much mechanical power. The amount of agency given the player to accept, reject, or provide alternatives to their ultimate fate gives the player too much tonal power for the kind of story that Planescape Torment was trying to tell. And there's the great irony. All of those things are structural features that people love about more conventional role-playing games, design elements that enhance a game, like Pillars of Eternity or Baldur's Gate, games where triumph is an important part of the artistic experience. What could this game have been if it never sought to be like Planescape Torment at all, if it had simply aimed to be the Tides of Numenera and oriented itself completely around the tonality of the new setting, the optimism of it, the exuberance of it? As it stands, Torment Tides of Numenera is a beautiful game with beautiful things in it, all of them in disharmonious contest with each other for importance and attention. But maybe that's just Numenera for you. What is the Ninth World, except a beautiful jumble of sound and color and experience? The game ends with a similar kind of accounting for crimes of the past as Planescape Torment, in a way that only really feels substantial here if you follow the plotline for a secondary companion named Um. is a big blob of jelly who cannot speak, just emote and convey images. Is cartoonish, but likable, like some kind of combination of sidekick and breakfast spread. But his past is, drumroll please, intensely tragic and depressing. The tides, the mythological feature from the game's title, are expressions of belief and intent like the alignments of the planes in D&D, except these winds blow everywhere and through everything. A silver tide for self-regard, a gold tide for compassion, a purple tide for long-term perspective, a blue tide for knowledge, a red tide for passion. Comes from a world where the tides were funneled and controlled. He's a rare creature that can manipulate them and teach others to do the same. The Changing God found last of his people on a dying planet, after some half-remembered cataclysm, and made a prisoner of him. The Changing God conducted experiments on that lasted millennia, eons of darkness and pain and manipulation of a creature that's like a gelatinous puppy in demeanor. What he learned helped him build the castoffs, let him become a god, caused the endless war. The sorrow is a being as ancient as and its purpose is simply to stop the tides from being abused. It's hunting the Changing God and all of the other castoffs because you all are, on a metaphysical level, causing great distress to the fabric of the universe. Obviously, that's bad and should be fixed. And clearly, the Changing God is just a colossal prick in every regard for pretty much most of everything he's ever done. But the Changing God's guilt is not your guilt. Only tells you these things if he's fond of you and has high regard for you as someone totally different than the one who hurt him. You are, in the typical methodology of the hero, cleaning up someone else's mess and not finding a way to make right your own. So, at the end of the game, the sorrow offers you a wide variety of choices, just like the Nameless One's last mortality offered him, but the impact of any of them feels slight by comparison. They all lead to widely divergent results in the epilogue. You can fight the sorrow, you can accept its recommendation and die along with all the other castoffs and Changing God himself, or you can create more favorable outcomes for characters you have sympathy for. No one choice is more valid than another, but the thematic difference between the results is way, way wider than any of the endings to Planescape Torment. Again, this is a feature and not a bug in any game but a Torment one. Respecting player choice, providing deeply varied player choice, this is a widely desired structural element for really any Western RPG. What's missing, though, is that fatalism, that acceptance of only having one choice, but room to maneuver regarding how that choice is made. The Nameless One must die, must finish the loop of himself, must pay for the pain he's caused. The last cast-off can do whatever the last cast-off feels is appropriate, because it's their agency that matters more than any individual characterization. You can accept punishment if you feel guilt, you can reject it if you don't. There was never any conflict over whether what is right for the player is right for the player character, because there was never enough distance between those two to cause narrative friction. But that friction was so much of the wonder and pull of the first Torment game. That friction eventually became a spark of fire, and the burning tension between the incarnation of the Nameless Ones that came before and the one that you play really lit up the entire game. Tides of Numenera is a wonderful adventure and well worth experiencing on its own merits, but it's an extroverted game, a story of stories, of strange places and strange people in even stranger combinations. It is an elsewhere. The original game, for however wild and strange the Great Wheel is, took place in the heart and the mind. It was a game of empathy, not exploration. Perhaps there will be a third game to unify the styles and resolve their differences. The rule of three certainly suggests that it ought to be so. But if there is, I hope it remembers what made the original game so classic and beloved was not the strangeness of it all, but its emotional familiarity. Planescape Torment used the fantastic to say something deeply, resonantly true. To forget that this is the root of the first game's success is to change the very nature of the series. Thanks for watching. This video, and all the videos I do, are supported by people who donate a small monthly amount through the crowdfunding website Patreon. Without the people who are donating money, these videos wouldn't really be possible the way they are, so I'd like to take a moment to thank by name all the people who are currently donating $10 a month or more. People like Cassie, Ron Gervais, Comfy Hat, Gabriel Nichols, Christian Zacharyanson, Eddie Burton, Soeib Sheik, Will Hooten, Milky Way Resident, Carol Henderson, Nick Cole Hamilton, Jack Dawson, Corey Bofill, Daniel Pennypacker, Dennis Clark, Eli Bergmass, World War II Freak, Morgan Mall, Alexander Leister, Kumarin Vigian, Igor Babiuk, Brian Hill, Jared Meyer, Andreas Larson, Kevin Schaub, Anthony Bardill, Anthony Barlow, Peter, Nicholas Rona Jorgensen, Ian Glascock,
Dan Stupcare, Lars Ingvar Anderson, Jack Korpstein, Matthew Sutton, Aaron Albach, Toad Hart, Jesse Wilkinson, Andrew Bregager, Sean Weber, Josh Greytack, Aiden AK-47, Greg Mirlis, Tim Moon, Reference Error, Matthias Hellstrand, Medal of Connor, Jody Warren, Tizar Vicarian, Devin Vernon, Kim Winson, Samuel Procopio Xavier, Oscar Stangenberg, Tom Painter, Blake Robinet, Jan Hendrik Hansen, Luke Murphy, Alexander Kronz, Will Dobbins, Sebastian Pironi, Noah, I know you're reading this out loud, Will Wargrave, Zach Z, Andrew Oplinger, Jack Harvey, Dice Prophet, Jonas Martinson, Nemo Vandenbrink, Anthony Gallant, Jeanette N, Robert Glover, Will Edwards, Jean-Philippe Malouin, Stephen Garrett Day, Carl Clark, Alex Zelato, Jason T. Barnes, Preston Allen, Philip Coffey, Sam, Clay Harrington, Anxiety Cat, Garrett Lathy, Andrew Boissonneau, Stephen Potyuk, Joaquin Coleman, Devin Fitzpatrick, Flibsy, Trivium Art History, Stephen Primol, Alex Nikiforov, Andrew Schiffel, Lupus Yonderboy, Brennan Ritchie, Lucas Barnard, Michael Atwell, Pascal Murray, The Soul James, Ryan Van Dyke, Andy Mitchell, Casey Pioli, Micah Shalom Kesselman, Bradley Smith, Gumdrops, Joshua Thomas, Daniel Moore-Myrie, Colin, Alex B., Andrew Foltz, Mikhail Aristov, El Weasel, Jared Olszewski, pardon me, Ryan Wilder, Scorpion Strike, Fakey McName, Sam Addison, Tyler Rush, Simon Nearfolk, Jordan Klein, Zach B., Edward Small, Matt Bergenquast, Sudana, Matthias Del Rilk, Wesley M., Sharif Kazemi, Harley McAvoy, I Cannot Fly, Artem Zernow, Dirk Warbrule, David Harpstride, Matthew Cassidy, Brett Gialmo, Evian Olio, Daniel Oren Christensen, Rich Storr, Free Morpheme, Daniel Morton, Yazan Barghouti, Lucas Kokan, Sorcerer Dave, Argus Swift, Nathan Jansen, Colby Howard, Adrian Komole, Mark Phillips, Sibs, Michael Soonenvader, Clayton, Andre Videla, Andrew Tapp, Tim Marsh, Raydev Akoy, Luke Fowler, Abdulrahman Ablabsi, Alexander Sundin, Noah Ford, Colin Schott, Connor McLeod, Nate Williamson, Daniel Pining, Dan Pop, Cybot D, Tom Rowerdink, Aurelian, Fergus Foley, Brynock, Darian Desitel, Lassilis, Carl Gleason, Kurt Hurup, Tim the Enchanter, Tyler Dowsey, C.E. Keen, Eric Jepson, Martin Karsten, Michael Kunin, Tui Nguyen, Chris Larkey, Leo Neal, Nobody, Andrew Steele, Dirk Warbrule, Brandon Boat, Matthew Mason, Galak, Josh, Dewey, Brian Plockelman, Chris Kayon, David Carlson, Sean, Jacob Siegelman, Pei, N.K. Jemison, Martin Sconning, Josh Farks, Ashley Rain, David McDowell, Aaron Darwin, Thomas Kistner, Ryan Snyder, Gordon Graham, Frederick Epel, April, Jacob McMillan, Skylar Vassallo, Eric Joyner, and many others. I really appreciate all the donations, including those of you who have changed, altered, or canceled your donations over time. Anything you've ever given me is incredibly helpful, and I'm still grateful for it. I'm grateful for all the ongoing support. Thank you for making these videos possible, and have a good one.